We acknowledge that we at Wilmot United Church live, work, worship, and play on the unceded lands of the Wolastoqui and the Mi'kmaq peoples. May we live our lives moving gently in creation, listening, learning, and striving to be a people of reconciliation.
Thank you, Angela. Nancy Chase is going to light our wonderful candles today. We light the wonderful candle of Christ that centers us and builds community with us. We also light the candle of affirmation that is a welcome for all, that this is a safe place to be. We welcome all of you to Wilmot and worship time. We are so glad that you are here and present with us. And we welcome you at home as well, that you are present with us and you are such a gift to all of the community. I believe we have an announcement from, there she is, all dressed in black today.
Stage four.
Okay.
Are we okay?
Yeah.
Three announcements. First, next week is Earth Day on Monday, and we're going to celebrate Earth Day next Sunday. And part of that worship, part of that celebration will be a showing of the video, My Name is Wolastoq, which is about the Wolastoq River, the St. John River. And we'll be showing that after church in the parlor. And so you're invited to bring a lunch if you like. It's only a 40-minute video, but we'll have muffins and cheese to tide you over. My second announcement is a reminder that your surveys with respect to the visioning team and the profile writing team are due tomorrow. So if you can drop them off in the boxes either here or downstairs. And if you need a paper copy of the survey, just let me know after worship. And the third announcement is that Ellen Bairstow, who was intending to be here to solicit some donations for the university students' pause program for during their exams, is not feeling well today, so she stayed home to keep all of us safe, and so I'll be down in the gym with the list of things that we need to help support the students as they write their last day of exams. And Bob Willis will be down there with me. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Shirley. We also have some happy news that the remit for the Indigenous Church under the umbrella of the United Church of Canada, the remit passed. So congratulations.
Can I use your mic?
Yes, you can use my mic.
Mary has given over the microphone, so my four-hour speech will now begin.
Service.
Yeah. Where are you going, Mary? two things. First of all, most importantly, you've already heard our oboist this morning, Fran Robinson, playing with the handbell choir, and we also have her playing along with the anthem this morning. So thank you, Fran. Much appreciated. And to conclude my four-hour speech, this coming Saturday, there is a fundraising concert here at WILMOT at 7:30. It's the Jim Axelrod Big Little Band with Amber Bishop. So Amber also often sings with our choir. I play in the band. It's going to be a great show. And the more people we get, the more we can contribute to the work of the outreach committee. So I hope to see many of you here, and feel free to spread the word. There's posters outside the gym as well. Thank you.
Exciting times at Wilmot United Church. Well, we are going to sing a beautiful song that is printed in your bulletins. We are trying a new format to see if that's easier for folks. And the song is, I Am a Child of God, 157.
You're going to have to look at their more voices, I think. It's in the bulletin for large print only.
Oh, is it? Okay, sorry. It's in the bulletin in large print only. My apologies. So you will have to look at the More Voices hymn book.
I am a child of God. I am a place of God's new creation.
Please be seated. Will you join me in the gathering prayer? Loving God, there is much that we don't understand, and yet we are here to celebrate with joy your resurrection life. We believe in your presence with us. We believe we have a future with you. You give us hope, but we see in a mirror dimly. We don't fully understand you, your ways, or the path forward. But with us today, reveal yourself to us. Warm us with a sense of your presence as we come to worship. Amen. We are going to sing the Lord's Prayer today. You'll find that on Voices United 959.
I'd like to invite up the children and anybody else who's feeling it. Excuse me. How's everyone today? Yeah, you all look good. Oh my gosh, Cora, are you Minnie Mouse? I love that. I love Minnie Mouse. Oh my goodness. Well, it's really great to see you all today. And today I wanted to talk to you about a story in the Bible. Now, it kind of goes in line with our Easter stories we've been learning in Godly Play. We've been hearing about the resurrection of Jesus. So we heard about the women going to the tomb and finding that he was not there, being told he was risen. We learned about the men on the road to Emmaus who were visited by Jesus and saw that he had risen. And now there were other people who had heard that Jesus had risen, but they didn't all really believe that he had. In fact, there was one guy who said, "I'm not going to believe that until I can see and touch his wounds, the wound in his side." So this got me thinking. I was reviewing this story and I was thinking, what does this mean? What does this mean for me and the children? What lesson can I take from this? And it actually took me talking to a friend. I talked with a friend of mine and I said, you know, I read what the liturgical magazine said about it, but I still didn't really get it. And my friend said, "Well, Amy, do you always have to see something to believe it?" And that got me wondering, do we always have to see something? No? Do we still believe in some things that we can't see? That's fair, yeah. I think so for sure. What are some examples of that you can think of? What? You forget? That's okay. I thought a really good example was God. Can we see God? No, we can't. But a lot of us here believe in God. And we might believe in him in different ways, but we believe without seeing. And that is called faith. We have faith. What did you remember? Right. Some people might not believe that somebody got hurt if they couldn't see it, but you kind of have to believe what the person said, right? Yes, Lauren?
Like my friend says, her little sister had COVID, mm-hmm. and she didn't.
Oh. She didn't really. Interesting. Right. And you couldn't see it. Yeah. So with things like God and a lot of special things that we learn about at church, we can't see them, but we do still believe in them a lot of the time. Gray, your watch is distracting me, buddy. Amy gets distracted a little bit. And that's called faith. So here at church, we talk a lot about faith. And faith is when you believe something, even though you can't see it. So we have faith in God, we have faith in Jesus, and we have faith that a lot of things we can't see, a lot of good, beautiful, spiritual, magical things are happening, and we just have to believe that, and that's all part, you guys, come on, that's all part of being in this place and practicing this religion is having faith and believing in things we can't see. So what I wondered is if any of you guys would like to help me by leading, you don't even know what it is yet. They're always, every time I say it, they're like, me? Would you like to come help me lead a prayer? Vale, would you like to come say a prayer for us to repeat? No? Do any of you want to lead the prayer today? No, none of you? Because we did that in Godly Play one time, and it was really special what the kids had to say. All right, if nobody's into it, I'll just lead a prayer. So can you please repeat after me? Dear God, help us to believe what we cannot see and feel your presence in our lives. Amen. All right, let's go to Godly Play.
For the next song that we are going to share together, it's in More Voices 114. We will all sing the refrain of the song, and then I will read the verses.
I'll stand in the choir, but they can stay seated.
You can remain seated, and the choir will stand. Thank you. did we see you ill and come to sit at your bedside? When did we see you, Lord?
Behold the face of Christ, O Jesus Christ, O living Christ, you rise among your people.
But when, Lord, when did we see you, the Christ, the Son of Mary, our brother, our God? When did we see you, Lord?
Behold the face of Christ, O Jesus Christ, O living Christ, you rise among your people.
Today's scripture readings are from the New International Version, John 3, verses 1 to 7. See what great love the Father has lavished on us, that we should be called children of God. And that is what we are. The reason the world does not know us is that it did not know him. Dear friends, now we are children of God, and what we will be has not yet been made known. But we know that when Christ appears, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. All who have this hope in him purify themselves, just as he is pure. Everyone who sins breaks the law. In fact, sin is lawlessness. But you know that he appeared so that he might take away our sins, and in him is no sin. No one who lives in him keeps on sinning. No one who continues to sin has either seen him or known him. Dear children, do not let anyone lead you astray. The one who does what is righteous, just as he is righteous. And Luke 24, 36 to 48, Jesus appears to the disciples. While they were still talking about this, Jesus himself stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." They were startled and frightened, thinking they saw a ghost. He said to them, "Why are you troubled? And why do doubts rise in your mind? Look at my hands and my feet. It is I myself. Touch me and see. A ghost does not have flesh and bones, as you see I have." When he had said this, he showed them his hands and feet. And while they still did not believe it because of joy and amazement, he asked them, "Do you have anything here to eat?" They gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate it in their presence. He said to them, "This is what I told you while I was still with you. Everything must be fulfilled that is written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms." Then he opened their minds so they could understand the scriptures. He told them, "This is what is written. The Messiah will suffer and rise from the dead on the third day, and repentance for the forgiveness of sins will be preached in his name to all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things." Herein lies divine wisdom.
May we receive the good news of Jesus the Christ today.
Thank you.
Let us pray. God of wisdom, please guide us to receive the gift within each of these scriptures. Help us to see your voice in the words. The words of many and the vision of many that we meet in your mystery and compassion through many ways of seeing and being. Amen. Well, I am so grateful for many things. Of course, I'm grateful to have that week off. I will inform you that I slept. And I slept. And I was so grateful for such special time to be able to do that. I'm grateful for the wonderful gift of Brian last week. I got a chance to watch that video last night and realized, hey, we're on the same road. We're on the same highway. Because he used a metaphor about roads. And lo and behold, so did I this week. But I'm very, very grateful. I know at this time of year, it's so easy to either deeply attach, as we have, through the beautiful music that we've heard this morning, of the Easter season. And for many, it's a perfect time to detach from Easter. It's done. Check. Turkey's been eaten, check, or ham, whatever. So we know that that attachment and detachment naturally flows, especially with the Easter story of resurrection. Not so much the Easter, because we do connect with that day profoundly, and very special things happen on that day. But it's afterwards. It's about living in this, we call it Eastertide, but really it's a season of resurrection. And what that looks like for us is quite different from what we read about in Scripture. We know that story so well, and yet we are living resurrection, and there's always this lovely time lapse, this gap. But we explore that, and we indulge in what that means in this 8 weeks. We never have to wait for resurrection, Richard Rohr notes, because what it takes for resurrection is quite simple, very simple. Every time we love someone, even if that connection is not reciprocated on the human level, we experience resurrection within our spirit. Jesus' resurrection, Rohr also notes, is not a private miracle. It is a world-changing pattern. Or a shift. In our faith story from Luke 24, we see that the entire Easter story is beautifully encapsulated in six little phrases, and Amy did a wonderful job recapping some of those. The women and two men are at the tomb, right? The women's announcement, definitely. Now, this is a little harder. Peter verifies it. Women of today might say, hey, hang on, let's back up a little bit. But anyways, Peter does verify that the tomb is empty, the road to Emmaus story, the gathering in Jerusalem, and of course, Jesus and followers in Bethany. Nice six little phases of the story. And each year we revisit these sacred texts in varying forms. It's a bit like entering the roundabout of faith with all kinds of exits and entrances. And we might look at some of those exits and we don't really know what's going to happen. Sometimes we do this. And sometimes we look at another one and go, I wonder if that's the exit I need. I'm not sure. Some of us get off the roundabout at the beginning of Lent and some rejoin it on Easter morning. Some think that the good news ends with Easter morning, and they move on with their wonderful lives, despite acknowledging how the story, according to the three of the four Gospels and Epistles, clearly states otherwise. God and Jesus are in cahoots against the powers of the world. God declares to the religious and political leaders, this is not about you. While they thought that they had the upper hand, they exercised all the power that mattered, so they thought. God declared that God has been working behind the scenes the whole time. Today's text that we hear brings the work of the ministry of Jesus a full circle. When we thought that today's story was over, God still has something to say for us and to us. It's always been about God, and it continues to be about God. Jesus did not launch into all kinds of explanations about his itinerary between Good Friday and Easter Sunday. Instead, Jesus taught and commissioned. His whole life, his death, his rising were about what God is doing in this world, reconciling the world to God's self. It has always been about God and God's purposes, aims and agenda and creation, always. It has always been about repentance that leads to forgiveness of wrongdoings, and it's a connection, a deep one, not just for ourselves, but for all of creation. But sometimes we still want to drive around in circles in the roundabout. Sometimes, it's true. We find comfort in old routines, ideas, and patterns. That's normal. We find new ways of being can scare us. We have read and prayed through the Easter faith story many, many times, and yet we still have, on occasions, missed the turnoff and found ourselves distracted by Easter egg trails. We cling to security of well-known routes. How many of you, if you think in your mind, take the same route home from Wilmot each week? Most of you? Some of you? It happens. Some of us don't have a choice. Some of us may end up somewhere in Killarney Lake if we did that. But the point is that we always take the same route. And what would it be like if you took a different route? As you are able, of course. Can we take a risk and try another exit? The exits of what ifs are very beautifully, beautifully labeled on roundabouts. What if I take this route? Where am I going to end up? Ooh, what if I take that route? I don't know where I'm going to go. I don't know what's going to happen. Yikes. The what ifs are everywhere in our current world and landscape. What if we looked up for the turnoff exit that God proclaims? And it reads, you are my child, come this way. And I have created you for goodness is another exit. So take, as Scott Peck declares in his wonderful book, The Road Less Traveled, a path based on love and nurtured in connections and new life. Taking an unintended path is rich with possibilities. One time, I may have told you this before, but in the summer, I had to take three absolutely bored teenagers in August to a movie. No big deal. Well, the movie was in Truro, and we lived way up in River John. So taking them to a movie meant a major hike. And we went, we made it. We watched the movie, we laughed, we enjoyed it, and then we were heading home. No problem. Only problem was I took the wrong exit. I didn't end up in one place, but it took me 45 minutes to go down the highway to finally find another exit to swing back. And I didn't even get on the right route then. I ended up on the secondary highway. So I thought, okay. And everybody was like, where are we going? It's like, I don't know, but we're in the right direction. And they were wonderful and patient, and they enjoyed the evening out, and lo and behold, a beautiful flash of northern lights broke out. And because we were on the secondary highway, we could see them. There were no lights from the streets or anything. It was gorgeous farm fields and everything else, but we couldn't see any lights. And lo and behold, there was this breathtaking view. And we followed the road all the way back home. It was a gift of the wrong turnoff, but it was well worth the risk. I mean, we could always sleep in a barn one night if we had to, right? And that gift of light was so precious and so beautiful that the kids still talk about it even today. They remember being lost and found all in the same night. Jesus asks us on that roundabout, take a path of faithfulness, recognizing what the love of God has given us. We were invited, as 1 John notes, invited into a new sense of family and relationship. Overall, I am good for a few potholes with a roundabout or two in my life, especially when I have Jesus and community as a relationship that holds me when that road does get a little rough. And we all have those roads too. But together, we circle. Exactly. Amen and
amen.
Amen. We have a beautiful hymn of Now the Green Blade Rises. That's Voices United 186.
Thank you.
beautiful are the wonderful seeds of life, and we are reminded in this new season that all growth is welcomed, and growth of our hearts, of our time, of our talent, and of our resources. So our offering will now be received. Gracious God, receive our offering. In Christ we pray. Amen. Oops. As we enter into our time of prayers for the people, there are many who are in our hearts today. At the end of the congregational prayer, we will finish with, I will sing praise to my God while I have being. Let us pray. Oh, God of new possibilities, we remember how Jesus, newly alive in our hearts and minds of his friends, how your spirit spoke through them of the good news they had seen and heard. Today we still seek signs of new life. Like many early disciples, we too have many questions and, yes, if we're honest, doubts. We long to find hope and good news, even in places of extreme struggle, places of suffering amid all of the troubles in the world and in our lives. God of new possibilities, we're offering you our prayers for those parts of the world where hope is really hard to find and where many, many people live in fear, surrounded by death and uncertainty. We pray for the continuing people that are working and struggling in Rwanda, the Ukraine, Haiti, Gaza, Israel, Palestine, and Iran. How far we still are from a world of peace and safety for all. May we not simply settle for our own comfort, but desire a good life for all of your people. This is your exit on our roundabout. And we pray also for abandoned and abused animals in need of food and shelter and love, and the work of our animal shelters, and all who seek to protect and befriend all of your creatures. We are mindful of fires that are ready to burst into flame in our woods and forests. And we pray for our land and water and air, so in need of deep healing for the sake of all living things. God of new possibilities, we pray for those among us and those known to us who are living with illness, who are facing medical treatments, and their families and their loved ones who need our support. May your undying hope and compassion touch them and all who are ill and all who are in any kind of difficulty. May we hold in love and light all those who are in our hearts today. May new light shine into the shadowed places of our lives, the light that you give, the light that shines through each of us. These and all our prayers We offer in the name of Jesus as we say together,
I will sing praise to my God while I have being.
Amen. Our song of departure today is Good Christians All Rejoice and Sing, Voices United 169. Two hands, and I am very blessed to have two. Upon them, you do not see marks. You do not need marks, because these hands do what God calls us to do, to hold, to love, to be present, and to give assurance, and especially movement signs when we're on our bikes. So bless you with your hands and mind and heart in this week ahead, to be the gift of God's love in the new resurrection. Amen.